when I thought of doing the gospel according to Michelle Obama, I immediately thought of interviewing you. And this is when I thought, well, it might be on Zoom and all that kind of thing, because I know you are a big fan of hers. But then you could be in the room, and I thought, why not co-host the service together? So can you tell me, what does this lady mean to you?
Well, I think as a woman and as someone who's a female leader in sports and spends my time advocating for girls and women, she's just such an incredible inspiration. And if I was to expand on that, until recently, I'd have said, you know, she's passionate about and vocal about girls in education. Also that she's someone who isn't afraid to speak truth to power and leverages her platform to... Yeah.
Truth to power, that's sort of talking about the prophetic, isn't it? Saying that God sees how the world is and this is how you need to look out for those that are maybe overlooked. Sorry, interrupted.
Yeah, no, absolutely. Yeah, no, definitely. And, you know, I think she just really leverages her position to amplify the voices of others. She's incredible. And, you know, for my girlfriends who are women of colour, you know, she has historical, she's of historical sort of profile and importance, breaking down barriers and stereotypes and, just using her platform to amplify others. But most recently, I listened to a podcast with an incredible woman called Priya Parker, who wrote a book called The Art of Gathering, and she described her philosophy of how she feels she wants to live out her life. And when I heard it, I was like, this is what Michelle Obama does all the time. And she said, in everything, every situation, ask yourself these three questions. What do I know how to do? Where is the need? And how can I help? And for that, for me, that really encapsulates Michelle Obama in her life as First Lady, but also in government, local government, and her not-for-profit positions. You know, where is the need? What do I know how to do? And how can I help?
Right. If you could email me those three questions, we put those into one of our emails and on Facebook this week, because they're good questions to think about. I've watched on Netflix, and I really encourage you, if you've got Netflix, to watch the Michelle Obama documentary called Becoming. It's an hour and a half, and it's about the tour she did off the back of the book. And I know you went to the tour, so what was that like?
Oh, it was incredible. I mean, it was amazing to hear her speak live.
Well, here's some pictures of you. That's you.
Yeah, that's me. And the second photo was taken by some of my girlfriends who were further back in the congregation. They hadn't managed to get into the crowd as far forward as me.
It's interesting. You almost said congregation.
I did.
So did it feel...
And
church-like.
It did, yeah, it did, because, you know, not only was it great that we were there to hear her, but there was a real power that everybody in the O2 was there because they stood and believed for the same things as her, or we believed in her, but also, you know, believed in her, what she stood for. But also, when we were lining up to go in, you could hear people excited, that anticipation. They went in expecting to be transformed and inspired.
Kind of like a candlelight service or an Easter Sunday service here, but obviously a lot larger.
Oh, it's
huge. If you've never been to TBC before, we don't look anything like the O2 Arena. We're just a normal, ugly 1970s brick building. So did you get in to see that quite easily?
No. So my friend Nadine and I, she originally was just planned to speak at the South Bank, and we had, I think, between the two of us, 16 devices open on our
16.
Phone and our laptops, and trying to get tickets, and we didn't. And there was a big uproar on Twitter, and everyone was like, if she'd planned the O2 instead of South Bank, it would have sold out. And I guess she listened to the people on social media, did it for that. And my husband Simon surprised me with a ticket for my birthday.
Fantastic. So he's got loads of brownie points there. So what was it like being there? Was it just one of those, you know, you get those few moments in life of I've got to remember this?
Yeah, it really was. That was actually the only photo that I took, was that one, and that was just before she came onto the stage when they were doing the pre-video bit, because I just wanted to take it all in. I wanted to absorb it. You know, so often we have our phones out and we're constantly, you know, filming, and then we reflect, but I just wanted to take it all in, and it was, really incredible to be part of that.
I can't remember where I've seen it. There's this great picture, and it's of loads of people watching a sporting event, and they've all got their phones out to take photos, and there's this one little old lady, and she's just stood there watching, and it says something like, live in the moment. Mm. And I thought, that woman's got something to say there. So how does Michelle Obama, and she might not, but how does she help you live like Jesus?
Yeah, so I think she really encourages me to speak truth to power, and also to remind me that integrity really matters. And I think, you know, when you're in a high position of office like she was, that integrity made her so much more distinct and counterculture. And I think it's important for us as Christians to be counterculture and distinct. And, you know, she encourages me in that way.
Brilliant. Thank you very much. We'll talk more later, Joey. Michelle Obama, she was born on the January the 17th, 1964. And she's an American attorney and author, and she served as the First Lady of the United States, as we know, between 2009 and 2017. And she was the first African-American woman to serve in this position. She was raised on the south side of Chicago, Illinois, and she was a graduate of Princeton University and Harvard Law School. And she had an early legal career where she worked for a firm, and she met Barack Obama there, and they married in 1992, and they've got two daughters. As First Lady, she served as a role model for women and worked as an advocate for poverty awareness, education, nutrition, physical activity, and healthy eating, as we saw in that first video clip that we watched together. And she's still influential. She's the most admired woman in America for the third year running, according to the Gallup's poll. And that's not because she's cool or trendy necessarily, it's because, as Joey said earlier, of what she stands for and the integrity that she has as a woman. I have to confess, I haven't finished reading her book, Becoming. I'm midway, not even midway through, I am reading it. But what caught me was when they came out of the White House and they moved to their own house, there was one evening where she was there alone, apart from the security people, and she got some cheese and bread out and made some cheese toasties, and stood in her house and thought, well, my life has now completely changed. There was a hint of loneliness there. And she says that she had felt lonely at times in their marriage. It almost felt like Barack had gone on honeymoon with his books that he was writing and left her on her own. And she struggled to be everything to everyone, and that was a process that she had to learn to get over. Recently, she said, public service is a bright, sharp, hot spotlight. And we know that she said on media in this pandemic that she's had a low-level depression about the Trump administration, about the pandemic, about other international situations going on. I admire her for sharing that feeling of loneliness. Someone else who felt lonely was Terry Waite. Terry Waite was a hostage in Beirut for 1,763 days. And in his book, Taken on Trust, he says on the back of the book, I had heard of the underground prisons of Beirut, the Lebanese gulag, as Terry Anderson described them. There were stories of prisoners being incarcerated for years in such places. I sat down again, he says, and began to prepare myself for an ordeal. First, I would strengthen my will by fasting. I would refuse all food for at least a week. Secondly, I would make three resolutions to support me through whatever was to come. No regrets, no false sentimentality, no self-pity. Then I did what generations of prisoners have done before me. I stood up and, bending my head, I began to walk round and round and round and round. Why is isolation so often used with prisoners, with people we want to terrorise? Quite simply because it's effective. Haven't we found in this pandemic that we've realised that the loss of community we've had, I don't know about you, but those things, those people that I take for granted, it has been blimmin' lonely coming in this church at some times in this last year and only having three or four people in here and having to maintain social distance. Those hugs, those handshakes, those slaps on the back, that laughter together, it's been taken from us. Listening to the Jeremy Vine show this week, they were talking about what we would do when we could hug one another and who we would hug first. And lots of people were coming on and talking about hugging this person and that person. And one lady brought me to tears as I listened as Jeremy Vine read out her text. And she said, I have no family. I live in a small village with one village shop. My only connection with other human beings is the occasional walk and going into my village shop. I wonder if my postman will give me a hug when we can hug other people. And driving in my car, I was engulfed in a wave of emotion for this woman that I have never met and whose name I don't know. Why? Because of her loneliness. I remember dating a young lady at this church and she dumped me. It's a phrase we use. It's fairly crass and horrible, isn't it? And I remember being with our youth group down at Winchelsea Beach and everyone hustling and bustling. And I felt so lonely. Because loneliness isn't just waiting for the postman to hug us, or being a hostage for thousands of days in Beirut, or being the first lady in America and now wondering what else lies out there for me. Loneliness can be experienced in the midst of a crowd, even of people we know. And I think that Mary experienced that loneliness in our Bible reading now. We're going to watch together John 19, verses 16 to 30.
So the soldiers took charge of Jesus. Carrying his own cross, he went out to the place of the skull, which in Aramaic is called Golgotha. There, they crucified him. And with him two others, one on each side and Jesus in the middle. Pilate had a notice prepared and fastened to the cross. It read, Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews. Many of the Jews read this sign, for the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city. And the sign was written in Aramaic, Latin, and Greek. The chief priests of the Jews protested to Pilate, "Do not write the King of the Jews, but that this man claimed to be King of the Jews." Pilate answered, "What I have written, I have written." When the soldiers crucified Jesus, they took his clothes, dividing them into four shares, one for each of them, with the undergarment remaining. This garment was seamless, woven in one piece from top to bottom. "Let's not tear it," they said to one another. "Let's decide by lot who will get it." This happened that the scripture might be fulfilled that said, "They divided my clothes among them and cast lots for my garment." So this is what the soldiers did. Near the cross of Jesus stood his mother, his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother there and the disciple whom he loved standing nearby, he said to her, "Woman, here is your son." And to the disciple, "Here is your mother." From that time on, this disciple took her into his home. Later, knowing that everything had now been finished, and so that scripture would be fulfilled, Jesus said, "I am thirsty." A jar of wine vinegar was there, so they soaked a sponge in it, put the sponge on a stalk of the hyssop plant, and lifted it to Jesus' lips. When he had received the drink, Jesus said, is finished. With that, he bowed his head and gave up his spirit.
I did a funeral on Tuesday of this week out in Darenth, where our congregation are, for a 25-year-old lad, taller and broader than me, strong, who died unexpectedly. I keep thinking, how do his dad and mum feel? How do they cope? How do they get up? How do they function? How did Mary feel as she watches her boy die on a cross? Her boy who'd promised so much, her boy whose nappies she had wrapped, her boy who fell and grazed his knee and she patched up, her boy who she taught at home, as was the Jewish culture, her boy who became an adolescent, who became a man, a boy who took over his father Joseph's carpentry business when he died and continued that with his brothers and sisters. Have you ever been there when somebody dies in those last moments? It's a strange mixture of pain and privilege. More pain, in my experience, than privilege. But death by crucifixion, that which the historians tell us is the cruelest form of inhumanity to humanity. No wonder Jesus said, "I thirst." The beating he'd taken, the nervous energy he'd used, the conditions of the weather as his battered body hangs there like rotting flesh. It's ironic that in his first sign, miracle in John, he turns water to wine at the wedding in Cana in Galilee, and it's the finest of wine. And here on the cross, he's given wine vinegar, a horrendous, awful thing just used to numb the pain. And at the foot of the cross there is his mum, her sister, Jesus's auntie, Mary, the wife of Clopas, a rich middle-aged woman who was probably the wife of Clopas and is related to one of the 12 disciples. Mary Magdalene, who'd had seven bad demons driven out of her by Jesus to help her become whole. And John, the disciple whom Jesus loved, who stands with Jesus' mother Mary. Notice that it's women who are at the centre. And in the other Gospels, they tell us that other women stood just away, that the men are nowhere to be seen. They've scarpered in fear with their tails between their legs. And yet it's the women that stand, as the Message version of this passage puts it, at the foot of the cross. Jesus is in the centre for them, even in this most bleak of moments. And I wonder what they were thinking. I wonder if Mary wondered if she could save her son. Even when someone is dying, you still have that daft thought, don't you? Maybe, just maybe it can change. Did Mary want to punch the Roman soldiers who callously gamble for her son's beautiful single garment, something she had seen him in probably dozens of times? Did their minds wander? Did they at some stage hope, just let it be over? Enough suffering. In the passage in verses 26 and 27, it says, "When Jesus saw his mother there and the disciple whom he loved standing nearby, he said to his mother, 'Dear woman, here is your son.' And to the disciple, 'Here is your mother.' From that time on, this disciple took her home into his home." Well, woman is the same affectionate and brittle phrase that Jesus used at the wedding in Cana in Galilee when he turned water into wine, when his mum asked him to sort it out. But the harsh brutality of this scene is softened by Jesus's care. He wants his mum to have a safe place, because unlike today, a woman in Jesus's culture without someone to protect her was in big trouble. And so in Jesus' dying moments, he wants to make sure that his mum has someone to look after her. Why not his other brothers and sisters, we might ask? But they had grown annoyed with Jesus. They misunderstood who Jesus was, and they had taken a back seat from him. And so maybe they'd taken a back seat from Mary as well, because Mary had misunderstood Jesus at points. But now she's right there at the centre of the cross. And maybe Jesus thinks she needs to be looked after and cared for by John. He will do a good job. And actually, John needs a mum. And so she'll do a good job for him as well. It says that later Jesus died. And we can infer in that that John took Mary away before Jesus actually died. That he protects her from that last hideous moment. The last verse says, when he had received the drink, Jesus said, "It is finished." With that, he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. Finished there means complete. It doesn't mean, oh no, I haven't quite, oh, it's finished. It means, no, I've completed what I've come to do. When it says Jesus gave up his spirit, it's not, it's like when the bell rings at school and your teacher, and you're all waiting, and they say, dismissed, and you grab your bag and you run out the door, that little competition, so you can get out first. The teacher is in complete control of when the class finishes. Apart from one theology lesson I had at Spurgeon's, we were sat out on the grass near the car park, and our lecturer was lecturing us. It was a two-hour lecture, and I put my hand up, and he said, yes, Neil. I said, John, can we please finish, because I'm switching off. He went, does anyone else want to finish this lecture? Every hand, 32 of us, all went up. And he went, well, I guess that's the end of the lecture then. But there isn't like that on the cross here. Jesus is the one who decides when things are finished. Because in John 10:18, he said, no one takes my life from me. I lay it down of my own accord. Jesus is not a victim here. Jesus is still in some way in charge. His action is voluntary and it's confident, even in the midst of his broken and batteredness. I wonder if we could hear Jesus in this scene. I wonder if we would hear him saying to us, look, guys, as you stand at the foot of the cross, gaze upon me, but also get to know the person who stands next to you and treat them as one of your family. Gaze at me as you stand centrally with me, but also get to know those around you in church and in your communities and in your neighbourhoods and treat them as family. How do we look to Jesus as we stand at the foot of the cross? A number of ways. Simply by reading the Gospels, worship songs and hymns that really connect you with him, walking in nature and looking for those crosses in the tree branches and the planes, plumes that go through the sky, watching YouTube clips that bring us back to Jesus. Whichever ways work for you in bringing you to the foot of the cross. And how do we support one another? How do we support the Johns and the Marys in our lives? How do we support one another as we come back together? Because let's face it, we haven't stood at the foot of the cross together for over a year. As Club Sunday came in this morning, one of the leaders said to me, I haven't been in this building for a year. It's weird. As we come back together, let's treat one another with compassion. Compassion for those who are too fearful to come back yet. Thought for those who are quiet and reflective rather than loud and celebratory. Understanding for those that want to see Granny in Bexhill before they come to a Sunday service. Let's treat one another with compassion that says, you can be my mum. You can be my son. Isn't that a key thing of Michelle Obama's life? Let's lose weight together so we're a healthier community. Let's look after those who've gone out and battled and their loved ones. Let's make sure that those on the lower rungs culturally are lifted higher. Let's look after our sisters and our brothers. On the 23rd of July 1992, the local police chief in Bettyville, Kentucky, told Rosemary Smith and her husband Luther that two of their sons, Jeremiah, aged 15, and Drew, aged 18, were dead. The brothers were returning from a concert in Indianapolis, Indiana, and they crashed their vehicle. Darkness, like nothing she had ever known, settled over Rosemary, yet she found solace in her faith. While following the hearses to the burial site, she heard church bells toll 33 times. "As I sat there and counted," said Rosemary, "it hit me that when Jesus died, he was 33, which was also the combined ages of my sons." Not long after her loss, Rosemary began a ministry called Fellow Travellers, a ministry to other grieving parents who have lost loved ones and have lost children. "I feel this is my mission on earth," Rosemary said of her ministry. "I now have a higher purpose than what I was doing, and the death of my sons took me there." Every day, Rosemary reads the newspaper and searches the internet for child obituaries. She either calls the family or sends them special packets consisting of books on loss, a music CD, a three-ring notebook of inspirational messages, and more. She gets about 50 emails a day from people requesting one of her packets. More than 5,000 packets, paid for by Rosemary and her husband, have been sent all over the world. "We are here to help other people," said Rosemary. "It gives me great joy thinking God is using me to help others." In our loneliness, if we feel like that, like the lady on Radio 2, like Terry Waite, like Michelle Obama at times, in our loneliness, let's look to Jesus and stay at the foot of the cross. And let's support one another as the family we are. Friends, as we respond, I'd like us to do something that you might find weird, and if so, then just don't involve yourself in this. I'd like you to close your eyes with me and to picture an archery board, which is life, with everything going on in it for you, your employment, paid or voluntary, your family, your hobbies, your church life, your neighbourhood. And Jesus is the red bullseye in the centre of your life. And imagine you as an arrow flying into all of that that you experience. We can fly into any area and put all of our passion and energy into home or work or hobbies or whatever it may be. But if Jesus isn't at the centre of all of those things, if we aren't at the foot of the cross, then I humbly believe we miss out on a depth and a richness of life. So as you picture the arrow that is you flying into that board now, that archery board, see it plummeting into the bullseye that is Jesus. As you stand, as I stand, as we stand at the foot of the cross, let's make that our commitment again, to be close to Jesus. And out of that closeness, to love our sister and brother in the world in which we live. Do you see the arrow flying in? And Jesus doesn't say, "Sorry about that, you're badly behaved," or "Sorry, you've never been to church before. I'm going to take that out and put it somewhere else." Jesus says, "Welcome. It is home for you here with me."